Okay, good morning, everybody. So welcome to our board meeting of August 15th. And our first item on our agenda is to welcome a new board member. He was replaced by a long-standing member of the board, Wayne. We were going to miss a lot, but I know that Mike O'Halloran is also going to do a wonderful job for us. And we're happy to have him on board. We're sorry that you've come at a time when we're in such flux in the middle of some important decisions. But I know you'll catch up.
Yes.
So with that in mind, Beverly, can you take roll call?
Thank you. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Chairman French.
Present.
Mr. Broker. Mr. Ellis.
Here.
Mr. O'Connor.
Here.
Mr. Dorn.
Here.
Ms. O'Dell. Mr. Jones.
Present.
Mr. Lukakis.
Here.
Mr. Mingle.
Okay, now we've heard from Mr. Mingledorf and Mr. Broker this morning. They both have medical issues. So I'd like a motion and a second to excuse them.
I make a motion that we excuse them.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? So the ayes carry. The next item that we're going to put on the agenda, it's not here, but we have a lady, Mrs. Artis Woods, who would like to speak to us briefly. So we'd like to open that up for her, and the floor is yours.
Thank you. I'm on the board of the Ardsley Park Neighborhood Association, and on behalf of them, I want to thank you for taking good care of our signs. They were not only restored when most of them came down in the city, and we care very much about the little things that make our place what it is. So they were put back, and recently they were all painted, a few were replaced that had been still missing, and so thank you. The other thing is, always interested in the beautiful space that we have in the public area. We look forward, hopefully, to having these go away. I calculated, I may be wrong, that you get 0.3% of your revenue by putting up these rolling billboards, and so if there's any way you can eliminate them, they would certainly add to the visual beauty of Savannah by eliminating them. That's all I have to say, and thank you for your time.
Kurt, do you want to talk about our resolution of the buses?
Yes, so just so you're aware, the board voted to stop doing full bus wraps.
Yay!
So we'll start branding CAT instead of other.
Bravo.
So we are, I think the bus wraps expire
February.
Mm-hmm. We have actively taken some of the wraps off buses that are existing now where the contracts are expiring.
Good news, thank you.
So you see prettier buses from now on?
Yes.
Okay, so now we'll get back to the agenda. The first item is to approve the minutes.
So moved. Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The motion carries. And Ms. Woods, thank you for stopping in.
My pleasure. Hurry on.
Okay, then we'll move on to action items. So the first item is the ferry boat rehabilitation ferries.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Staff request the board to approve the purchase of press board approve the issue of the ISB, which is invitation for bids for ferry boat rehabilitation. As the board is aware, the CAD has been awarded an FTA grant to complete major rehabilitation work on all three of our ferry vessels, or four of our ferry vessels. And we're ready to put out an invitation for bid. FTA funding covers 80% of the cost, and the 20% local match is covered by the Trade Center.
Any discussion?
Are we going to make sure this time that we have people, Curtis, that's going to, you know, when it's going to be rehabilitated, that it's done in the proper way, and so that we don't have problems like we did in the past, you know, about things that weren't done properly, and we got fouled up with that pretty much.
Yeah, I'm not aware of any of that, but we will be, you know, issuing an invitation for a bid for the naval design architecture and all that stuff, and so we're not, however it was done in the past, I'm not aware of. But we, of course, will follow all policies and procedures and regulations when it comes to doing this.
Well, you take care of a lot of good things for us, and I want to make sure that we have somebody from your staff that would be, you know, checking it out. That is,
yes, Mr. Jimmy Gumby sits behind you as our Director of Marine Services, and he'll be overseeing all of that.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Bill, I think you raised...
Never mind. And are we going to have like a strict time limit on this? I live down by that overpass on Abercorn, and we're still waiting for completion. Is that going to include a specific time frame for completion when the job's issued?
Yes, sir. When it goes out for bid, they'll have a time frame, and we're doing one at a time, so it won't impact our service.
Okay.
That we're able to.
This is specifically for the Florida Sports.
Have we done the others, or are they in line to be done next? I mean, do we have are we going to have to do them with multiple ferries, and do we have a plan for how that's going to be done?
Yeah, it'll be one at a time, so it doesn't impact your service. I believe this is the...
This will be the first one. We've done some minor. In 08, 09, we did the rehabs before, so this will be the second rehabs for the 2003 vessels. So when we get Florence Martis done, we've already done the air conditioners on both the small boats and the generator, so we've piece a little bit of it together, but it'll be the major rehabs will be one at a time, so one will go out for rehab as soon as the other one comes back. So
do we have to retire these at some point, or can we keep doing rehabs and keep them in service indefinitely? Is there a
depreciation? They do have a lifetime. The hulls were, I believe, 50 years, 25 or 50 years, so we're still in that time frame. But what we're doing right now is mainly the propulsion systems, the generators, engines, drive systems, things of that nature. So the outer body is good for another 8 years, I believe.
That's the limiting factor
for the rehabilitation.
Yes, sir.
And actually, these rehabilitations, because they've been planned one after the other, and because we've identified capital grants funds for them, will extend the useful life that we currently have on our fixed asset schedule for the parent boats, by definition.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Then we'll ask for a motion to approve.
So
second.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. So, Curtis, let's stay in the water then and move on to the RFP.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Staff request board approve issue of a RFP, a request for proposal for Naval Engineering Design Service for construction of a new ferry vessel. It's basically shown that economic development on both sides of the Savannah River indicate that, and we've worked with the Trade Center in discussing this, is that there will eventually be two triangles of service instead of the current one to service both the east and the west side. And in order to do, we cannot do that with the four vessels, so we would need an additional vessel. Staff has worked with Georgia Department of Revenue, Department of Transportation, and we've identified some funding from the Federal Highway Administration that was going to be deobligated, and we worked with GDOT and were able to capture that and reallocate it. About $1 million for the vessel construction, about $500,000 for the dock.
I would like to, before we approve this, I would like to say that this is kind of an impressive coup by Grant to find the money to buy this boat from an expiring grant that was living in the highway department. So I'd like to congratulate the CAT staff for being a little more alert and a little more creative when it comes to searching these funding opportunities. But now for discussion.
I echo that. I had a question. Was that the expiring money something from this area, or did we manage to get somebody else's money? That would be even better.
Yeah. Hopefully got somebody else's money.
Go ahead, Barry.
So, unfortunately, it was earmarked for this area, but it was very old. There was a 2006 earmark. It was an L950 earmark. And then there were also two grants, a very discretionary major maintenance grant and a catch-all project that were all kind of identified for this area, but they were older funds. So they were within a few months of being lost when we started working with the Georgia Department of Education.
That's right.
Right. It's old money, but we were able to, and staff has been very aggressive going after all grant funding opportunities, and this is an older item that we went after and were able to capture right before deobligated.
Yeah. And more broadly speaking, your comment that staff has been good about going after any kind of grant. Throughout this, every time I turn around, you guys have found another grant to go for it. I think that's great. You know, that's going to really help fix a lot of problems with the system, I think, that we couldn't do with operating funds. Does this new boat change anything significantly from previous boats since it's, you know, years have passed since these original boats, the boats we have now, were built? Is there any, you know, upgrades, any new technology, anything that's included in this new boat?
Yes, sir. We'll have all the latest and greatest radar, radios, technology, but the biggest thing for this is going to be our passenger count. The older boats, the O3s that we're rehabbing with engines and generators, they were brought down to 86 passenger counts by the Coast Guard. They raised the weight a few years ago to was 145 to 165, which in turn regulates how many passengers we can carry on the boat. So with the increase at the trade center that they're going to be doing the construction and adding the other dock, the new vessel will be rated for 149 passengers versus the 86. That way, when we're busy, we have enough capacity where we can carry everybody and move them in a good amount of time.
Good. So since this is over money, so do we have a time frame that we have to spend?
Yes.
Is it a timeline?
Yes.
Yes.
18 months?
Yes.
So then we need to move it.
Yes.
Rather than stand around and talk, we need to move it.
Yes.
We're going to vote.
Right now.
Vote right now.
Motion done.
We're in discussion on this out west. One of the first ferries that we got, they didn't, it was too slower than the all the plans said what it should be. In addition to that, it was very noisy. And they had another something else was, and so we got that boat that was in, and it was being operated for a period of time with all of that going on, and there were some complaints that came from people that were riding on it, and the time element for that to get across the river, and that's just some, there were three specific things on that.
It was the noise, sound reduction, it was capacity, and it was speed. And when we did the naval architects contract last time, and also the shipbuilders contract, we made those three elements essential.
We corrected that on the 2012 item.
And so that means that new regulations are in, so we don't have to worry about that. We got old money, but we don't get a new book.
Right, and the RFP will handle all of
these things. All
issues. Does it take as long to build a boat as it does a bus?
Yes.
Takes a while.
Right. So once we commit, we spent months. The money, so it doesn't matter in the sense of the money. It doesn't matter how long it takes to build.
As soon as we can get board approval to issue the RFP, GDOT will formalize and execute the contract. Then we have that 18 months to finish the construction of the boat.
And we can do it in 18 months.
Yes.
Okay, any other questions before we move? Do we need a motion on the floor?
Move.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. A new boat.
That's exciting.
Send that contract.
That's what I'm talking about.
Chester says sign it today, Terry.
Today.
Get the boat going.
We sign the draft today, and then we'll sign the final contract as soon as it gets
approved. Okay, so the next item up is the, we're staying on the water today. The next item up is the insurance renewal for the...
I'm important today.
Really?
Third item?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Staff requests board approve fine coverage based on the renewal proposal provided by Seacrest, liability, excess liability, and whole coverage that renews later this month. In the June board meeting, they discussed this, and the amount that it has increased, we have it in our budget. When does it actually expire, Terry?
The 20th.
20th.
Of this month?
All of our other insurance premiums are set to expire either close to or at our fiscal year end now, but this was off cycle and has been for the last 4 or 5 years, so this particular policy expires on the 20th of August.
Did I read this right? It sounded like, and I wasn't sure I was reading it right, that it was lower than what you, it's still higher than previously, but it was lower than what you had budgeted or projected?
Correct. We've got budgeted funds, and also this is a pass-through. So the entire cost of this insurance, plus the part of our property that relates to the docks, is covered by the trade center fee for ferry service.
So when we have enough time in between now and the 20th to exercise all of the legal...
Yep, they're ready. We just need this last approval.
Is this a one-year premium?
1 year.
1 year. Okay.
Jay?
No, I'm not.
Okay. Move to accept.
Second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Okay. Bus and bus facilities grant application. This is another interesting Curtis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Staff request board approve submission of FY17 bus and bus facility grant application. The FTA announced over $200 million in competitive funding under Section 5339B for transit buses, equipment, or related facilities. We're requesting board approval so we can apply for some of the grant funding.
I feel compelled to make a comment here that all of this grant activity that we're seeing seems to have stemmed from the time when we hired someone named Grant Sparks.
That's why he gets them, because of his name.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. At Freedom Vehicle Purchase, Curtis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Staff requests the board approve the purchase of 3 ADA compliant vans under the section, FTA section 5317. It's called the New Freedom Program. We're used to access that money to support our capital operating costs. Basically, Cab Freedom is our on-demand taxi service that we work with Yellow Cab on. We've already purchased, I believe, 9 vehicles. We're looking to purchase 3 more using that Cab Freedom funding. The lowest bidder was Creative Bus Group at $137,000 per vehicle.
Are these going to replace any older units, or are these on top of what we already have?
It's on top of what we already have. And then our paratransit fleet replacement will be done by the end of this year.
So how soon will they be in operation?
2 weeks. Yeah, pretty quick.
When you say paratransit will be in place by the end of the year, do you mean the orders or the vehicles?
The vehicles should be here by the end of the year. And then our goal is, as we discussed previously with the workshops, that we would keep some of the older vehicles, or the newest of the old vehicles, back, so we actually have a spare ratio. We can actually use them for other means, like in areas where we don't need a large 40-foot bus, for example. Currently, we're running with no spare ratio at all. So when a vehicle breaks down, it's bad.
So you're thinking about coming to service not just for backup paratransit, but
yeah, right. But utilized for however we see the need for it.
Do we need a second?
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, and then this should interest Bill Durrance. The City of Savannah Circulator Service Agreement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Staff request board approve the circulator service agreement between the city of Savannah and CAT. And as you're aware, we've been working with the city for several months to redesign the downtown circulator service from the Dodge shuttle and the Liberty Street shuttle into a more higher frequency downtown circulator. A few different options were put out to the city. There's an option was agreed upon. We're at the phase now, as Mr. Dern said, to get this thing to get done, where we just need to execute a contract, and then we're looking to start September 25th.
That's great. And it looked like, I was reading it right, that, I don't know if this was in here or something subsequent, that the way the city is going to support an expansion of the service might be through helping with capital expense.
Yes, sir. So that the city, obviously, if you're aware, operating is tight, but capital, there's room. And so they decided to buy in on the capital side to reduce the operating cost.
And CAT has no problem taking money that way?
Absolutely not.
As long as you get the money?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And we've run this through the regulatory compliance piece and also our current auditor. So there's no problem with the way we've set the contract up.
Now this, I recognize, has nothing to do with the senior circulator. Are we
no,
doing
that's a
anything
separate
with that at this point, or does that just continue?
Again, that's a city-funded service, and the direction we've received from the city is that will remain intact until an alternative has been brought up.
Yeah, referring to stuff we'll get to later with KPI, I'm amazed that the senior circulator seemed to be dying until we talked about discontinuing it, and now the service grows every month. So I guess that's good. I mean, it's providing a useful service.
Yeah.
And we're billing that service on a monthly basis at cost, and we'll do that until the city.
I'm conflicted about that, billing at cost. You understand. And I know as a CAT board member that we need to get paid, but as a city councilman, I'd like to get it for free.
Okay, well, you're in the room where you were a CAT board member.
So do now, is there any changes to the from the present route to the new route?
There is changes.
So are we going? We have time left between now and September 25th to advertise and let folks know?
We've been doing that actually.
I got a question. How competitive? I guess because this being a free route being supported through the city, how competitive is it with regards to our fixed routes in hours and dollars being made? Because I didn't see the competitiveness of it.
So the city of Savannah shuttle will be supported 100%
by the city.
By the city.
Understood.
And our fixed route cost is supported at approximately 14% by fares received.
And I understand it's being paid by the city. My question is, are we getting the right rate? I just want to make
yes.
sure how we determine the right
is
rate
that
we're
cost,
charging for
is that cost less the depreciation, which they're buying that rate with
uh-huh.
their $710,000 capital contribution.
Okay.
This is a loaded cost.
We have a loaded cost, and that's the $96 per hour. And
right.
then when you take depreciation, which represents the capital piece out, it lowers that to the $78 an hour. So they're buying the rate by a $710,000 upfront contribution,
mm-hmm.
which represents that delta, which was the capital depreciation cost
James.
In the $96 rate.
So the rate we're charging is
exactly the same
all expenses
as
covered
else's.
Except
yes.
for the depreciation
yes.
which is given to us in the
upfront.
Upside.
Yes,
yes,
sir.
Upfront.
Jay's question actually makes me think of something. These shuttles, I mean, not only the new ones, but the existing shuttle route, that, I can't imagine what that I need to ask, I guess. Does that have any impact on our fixed route ridership? Somebody that might be using fixed routes to move around downtown? Or
it does help with the fixed route.
It helps with the fixed route.
Right.
It doesn't
and,
actually
and
take
that
ridership away.
No, that ridership does count, and it allows us to cover that area without an additional fixed route or cost associated.
And we report a ridership. I can go on the book. We report a ridership for
yes.
that.
Yes.
Okay.
We have counts. Are we doing counts on those?
Mm-hmm. I think it's at the bottom.
It is. Yeah. When you expand on the proposed routing for this new downtown service, that's when we will start to compete with our fixed route. With its current footprint going as far south as Forsyth Park, I think we're okay. The goal is to circulate people around the downtown area and get them here as well to hop on the fixed route. But when you start branching out even further with fare-free service, people will ultimately start taking that service instead of our fixed
route. Yeah, I was
going
to ask that question. Now.
So we do need to think about that moving forward for fare-free expansion.
But if we're, I mean, we're competing for ridership, but if the city is subsidizing the entire cost of that, or covering the entire cost of it, that's actually better than having to spend on federal grant money and a 14% recovery rate.
It would just be a different category of ridership.
Right, it's a different category of ridership, but actually financially it could be better for CAT to have the whole thing paid for by the city than depending on fare box.
We can incorporate that into the system redesign and reallocate the resources we were using for the shuttle area to the other.
Well, what it would do is it would eliminate, it could be possibly eliminate those big buses in the downtown district if we did expand it correctly. And then we can create, I guess, other fixed routes to fix into that whole downtown expansion.
The one variable that we have to keep in mind, though, is that per FTA guidelines, wherever you have fare-free service, you have to have fare-free paratransit service. So that is one thing where we would incur more costs. Would be if we expanded the fare-free zone, essentially.
Okay.
We have to provide fare-free paratransit as well.
And we're indemnifying the city under a blanket coverage, or we're indemnifying them just for accidents on the bus?
It's anything arising from the operation of the route.
Anything from arising out of the operation of the route.
And we generally do not indemnify other contracting parties, but in the case of intergovernmental agreements where the two parties indemnify each other, we make that exception and do indemnify each other.
Okay.
Well,
you said we indemnify each other?
Yeah.
Where are they indemnifying us? I see section 9 where we indemnify them. Well, we hold them harmless.
Oh, well, right. In this case, since CAT is operating the system entirely and the city's not playing any part in the operation other than paying for it, there is no reciprocity.
Well, let me ask you this. If there's a, say there's a sinkhole that pops up and, you know, we have certain attorneys that will sue for the sinkhole because the bus fell into the sinkhole. Who sued? Both of us? Or it's just the CAT?
Well, let's back up to the beginning. Both CAT and the city are protected by sovereign immunity.
Right.
Plus, we have insurance. Both CAT and the city have insurance also for certain risks. So there's no way to predict who can be sued. Anybody can be sued. They may be wrong when they file the suit, but anybody can be sued. But as far as the city may have responsibility for the pothole.
And we have responsibility for the injury on the bus.
Responsibility for operating the bus if there was any negligence.
Okay.
On the insurance subject, and who's going to insure the bus? Who owns the bus? Are we going to own
the
bus?
We own the bus.
We're just going to pay.
And we will insure the bus.
We just have a guarantee. That's all.
Right. That's just our way of paying for the service.
Like, that's a guarantee.
Just
pay.
Like
giving you the money to buy the bus.
To make sure that we have service in that area.
Yes.
I mean,
there's no ambiguity there.
Mm-hmm. So now, as it deals with the paratransit in this scheme of things, those buses are not equipped for?
All of our vehicles are paratransit. Okay. They have wheelchair accessibility.
Okay.
Yeah.
Everyone, okay.
So actually, since the shuttle vehicles are ADA compliant, they satisfy the transit need in this free service area.
That's what I
the paratransit is a different type of service.
Yeah.
But as we encourage people to use fixed route, more and more it could.
Yeah, they can choose, right. It's accessible to them as well. Yeah.
So what you're saying is even them being paratransit, accessible, we still have to offer that piece?
Yes.
If they're certified to be able to ride paratransit, then they can choose to ride paratransit.
I got you.
Right. So some disabled members in our community can ride fixed route vehicles because they can get on with a wheelchair on our buses, but some of them have disabilities that prevent them from actually getting on our fixed route. And those are the individuals that are eligible for our paratransit.
So that's considered, I guess, a fixed route, not being called a fixed route?
That's, it would be called, that's the paratransit, would pick up those customers.
They have to be taken exact location, can't be dropped in a corner.
Right. I see the difference, yes.
Yeah, we wouldn't be deviating the fixed route bus to do that.
Right.
Any other questions?
No approval. Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Okay, next up is the system redesign and the attached. Oh, and Ms. Savannah State, you're right there. I missed it. You're right. Next up is Savannah State.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Staff requests board approve an amendment to the MOU between Savannah State University and CAD. CAD has had a longstanding relationship with Savannah State. I'd like to recognize Mr. Jolly, who's in our board meeting. Thank you for coming. CAD provides service within and near SSU under existing MOU, and each semester SSU pays a fee for the service based on the number of enrolled students. Section 14 of this MOU provides an opportunity for each party to extend the term 1 year increments up to 3 years by means of a contract amendment. So staff recommend the board approve the amendment to the MOU.
Question. The section before that, CAD provides service each semester based on the number of enrolled students. If we're charging based on the number of enrolled students, that $45 fee, does that cover our full cost?
The amount of hours that's agreed upon based on the number of enrolled students.
Okay, so we are tying.
Yes, sir.
So we're making sure that we don't wind up providing a lot more service than the number of enrolled students times 45.
Correct.
So
it's the number of enrolled students at the college or in this program?
At the college.
Their student ID gives them a free ride.
Right.
So we've looked at the three-year average. We know on average what enrollment is, and then we multiply by the fee and compare it to the $96 per hour per service hour for the shuttle.
Uh-huh.
And that's part of the reason why the per fee increase is included in this MOU.
So it was not meeting the cost.
But we probably don't, at the fee, we don't lose money because all the students don't ride the bus.
Right.
And we pay for every student that's enrolled.
That's correct.
So.
And some students ride the bus multiple times, but it's based on enrollment.
Right.
It used to be a $35 an hour enrollment, which did not cover our cost. And now it's like $35 an hour.
But our costs are not really related to how many people use the bus. Our costs
service
are related
hours.
To the service hours.
The
service hours is agreed upon parallel to the role.
And there are existing fixed routes that they're using. There's no special routes for it.
There's an on-campus shuttle, but then there's existing fixed routes around the campus too.
This is not about the fixed routes. That's external. This is internal, right? On campus.
Yes.
Internal to the campus, and then there are some extensions off campus, I think, for a couple of shops.
When you say some, we're not talking about those who catch the bus here at this location and go to college?
Right outside.
24?
Right outside the campus, there's a route in Skidaway
right.
That goes to the mall. I think that's
what you're talking about. That Skidaway route parallels and puts you where you're going.
Right.
Okay. And then there's a route 12 that comes right outside the campus at the entrance on Thalia.
Right.
That gets people to all the other routes.
Doesn't their ID give them ridership throughout the system?
It does. So they with this agreement, the fee they pay allows the students to ride our system fare-free. It's similar to the City of Savannah Employer Pass Program, where mm-hmm. the city pays us an annual fee and their employees ride the system free.
And so the $45 covers so that we're not at a deficit at any time, right?
Well, we're not at a deficit for the shuttle.
Mm-hmm.
But in addition, they get the benefit of using the entire system.
But that's in our planned budget. And the only time there was a reduction in net fares was the first year we implemented. And it was equal to the amount of students that used to ride the bus and pay the fare that were now riding the system for free.
do want to state that this is very important for us, because this one right here can parallel us into GSU, the SCAD, and all these other schools in this area. So
SCAD has their own bus, though.
Yeah, but you never know what SCAD might need cash to come see.
Along that line, I don't know if we've heard back from SCAD yet or not, but a grapevine word I got was that SCAD is tilting away from the joint service. The other schools, Armstrong,
I say Georgia Southern because in 12 months it's going to be.
Well, it will be, but they have not in the past signed on to paying a fee in student members, but student IDs allowing them to use the system, have they? Armstrong hasn't been part of that program.
We have not.
We haven't had that conversation with them.
We have that conversation with Armstrong. Have we had a conversation with GSU yet?
We have not. Last week we did meet with CETA, and they are at the table with us now to try to have some communication, or that we can get the decision makers at Georgia Southern, Armstrong, to come meet with us so that we can determine the needs. Mm-hmm. So we have CETA involved now.
So you're at the table now?
Yes.
Okay. Move for approval.
Second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Next up is the system redesign, which is the ridership and efficiency of prudent resolution and the fixed route consulting services. And talking to Curtis this morning, with Bill Broker and Frank Minglemore being off, and the fact that we sprung this yesterday on Mike, Tabitha, and I think this is the first time, Jay, you had a chance to see it.
Yes, sir.
We're going to push this back to the next board meeting to give us a chance to discuss it a little farther at the August 29th workshop. It's a lot to absorb, and it's a big decision, and we want to make sure that the whole board weighs in on this and that we're all on board with this.
And we can do the same thing for number 9.
Yeah, we're going to table both.
Get him right.
We're going to take his, he's going to stab you with his pen.
Only
help. Yeah, we want to table both his motions until next. So we need a motion to approve.
Second.
And I want to indulge myself a little bit to talk about this, though, just briefly. I went 3 weeks ago to a board members seminar in Chicago for AMDA. And there were three major topics that kept running through the seminar. One was the lack of funding and what is the Trump administration going to do moving forward. Second was ridership. And the third was how bad everybody's equipment is, from buses to rails to anything that involves transit. And what I took away from this is, as far as ridership goes, this will mean something to those of us that have been on the board for a while. Ridership of buses across the country is down, has been down, and is getting decreasingly down. So it's a increasingly negative slope for bus riding. Around the country, all the boards are doing the same thing we're doing. We're sitting here, we're discussing what are the reasons, and we're coming up with. Price of gas is down, people are staying at home, not as many people are going to the mall, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And the action that they're taking is very similar to where we are right now. Everybody is either thinking of doing a system redesign, they're doing a system design, or they've done a redesign. And what seems to be the prevailing thought process is that everybody is redesigning towards this 80-20 model, with the theory that the reason that ridership is declining is that it's not convenient. You've got hour turnarounds, the buses are not giving you the frequency you need, so people have other alternatives for taking it. So the people that I met that have done the system redesigns, and they've been around the 80-20, in one case they were 100%, are seeing either increased ridership, or they're at least stopping the decline, or they're back to where they were before. So the system redesign, looking at the 80-20, does seem to work. And I think for CAT, we have to look at this, because if we do nothing, we're going to continue to go backwards. when I looked at the report that's a little farther in the back of the book, we're now at historic lows since 2012. I mean, our 16.3, 16.5 is as low as we've ever been. So if we don't redesign the system, we're going to be looking at lower passenger cost per load, higher passenger cost, lower ridership, and we're going to have to become reactive again. We're going to have to start decreasing routes, which we don't want to do. So this is something that's really important that we have to address, and we have to address it with Cat's promise, Grant Curtis, that we're not going to leave people behind.
All right.
So we have to do this in such a way with either demand service, van service, or something with Lyft or Uber. We cannot leave folks behind. So while I'm personally supportive of the 80-20, I want everybody to make sure that we don't, our mission here is not to leave people stranded on the side of the streets. So that's when we talk about this next week at the workshop, and this is where my mind is, and this is where we want to get our hands around this redesign. Bill?
Just an FYI to go with that. Someone that Grant had mentioned previously in terms of these systems that have done the redesign was Jared Walker, is that right? Just so you know, I don't know, we haven't seen the program yet, so I don't know if he specifically will be here, but the odds are he will. Next May, the CNU National Conference will be in Savannah. The Congress for New Urban Systems, and it's a lot of guys like Jared Walker who are dealing with a much more aggressive approach to new urban design, which is transit as well as some of the other things. And the National Conference will be here next year, and almost certainly there will be transit pieces of this. One of the things, and this is all still in the early proposal stage right now, but one of the things that CNU does is legacy projects, where they come in and they pick three, four local projects to use all their expertise to create, you know, ideas, plans, designs. And one of the things that is in that short list of proposals that the local group that's kind of parenting this whole thing is, do you remember the specific thing? It's something about transit. I don't remember.
Last I saw, it was to do a demonstration project of potentially having a dedicated bus lane along a corridor in Savannah to show what a BRT type of system would look like. I know that was one proposal. I'm not sure that that's the one that you're supposed to be talking about.
And I think that BRT?
I'm sorry, bus rapid transit.
Thank you.
I started my tenure.
I don't have my this.
You know, sorry.
I started my tenure on this board mentioning they use more acronyms than anybody else I've ever.
You need a cheat sheet.
Well, we got our acronym sheet now. So
you got your cheat sheet.
I need a copy.
You use your cheat sheet.
I never got a copy. Of this.
Give him a cheat sheet.
I am. And laminate.
Give him
this
laminate.
This conference will deal with a lot of urban issues, and transit's going to be one of them. And Walker will probably be here. If everybody wants to just kind of make it up in the back of their mind, it could be a good thing to participate in.
So it's in May?
Yeah, I don't remember the exact dates, but I think it's about the first part of May every year.
Do you go to their website and get it?
And actually, Nick Elholtz, who was with CAT at one point, is the head of the committee that's planning some of the local activities, the workshops and things like that.
Maybe you can give us the dates?
Yeah.
Do they have a website?
CNU, I would just Tom.
Well, we'll get you guys. I have it May 16th, 17th, 18th, 19th. And I understand it's going to be stuff before and after those.
Yeah, there's all kinds of things that happen with this. I went for one in Seattle last year just to kind of get a feel for it. And it's a really terrific program. And because of Savannah being Savannah, really kind of ties in. One of the things that a lot of these folks talk about is how they actually learned a lot about new urbanism by coming to Savannah and measuring Savannah, measuring streets, measuring setbacks. And Savannah's been used as a real role model for a lot of this stuff. And so the anticipation is that there could easily be 2,000 people here for this conference next year. It's going to be a big deal.
So wouldn't it be to our advantage if the board would go ahead and find out the details and get so that we could, if they've gotten multiple workshops going on, then
some of us could break out and go to different workshops so that we can bring the whole thing.
Absolutely, and one of the things that that is offered is a municipal or corporate sponsorship for, I think it's $25,000, and you get 5 tickets for that. So
5 tickets is 9 of us.
Well, you won't need to pay for mine. I'll be there already. And I'm not suggesting necessarily that we spend the $25,000. Certainly, there's a way to participate in this, and if Kat has some sense of willingness to participate, I'll bring that up because we've got a committee meeting coming up very shortly, and I'll make a point of letting that be known.
So can we go ahead and table this and move on?
Yes, sir.
Motion to table. Discussion.
Yeah. Mr. French, one thing I want to make sure in line with what you originally
were talking about. We voted to table. Can we start a discussion?
No. If you have a motion to table, there's no discussion. You take the vote, and that's the end of it. Until you bring it off the table, take it off the table at a subsequent meeting.
So, but that motion was made. I'm the only person going to be blocked out for having to get a conversation.
Me too.
Did
I miss the motion?
Because it was other conversations being made, if that's correct. And I know Marvin rules just like you do, sir.
Okay, so then I'm going to entertain a motion to untable.
I appreciate it.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
And I thought we were just in discussion, and I think Howard was just giving points of reference to a table motion we already closed out.
Yeah, I thought we closed it.
We already closed that table.
No,
Howard said that he wanted to inflict his point of view at the whole piece and we discussed it.
And that's when he jumped off the rule book.
Who jumped off the rule book?
All right. Well, Mr. Howard, to comment again to what you were saying, and I just want to put this out here, I think a part of ridership and when we're talking about doing this design is we got to make sure that our customer has a rite of passage to get to the ridership point. And I think that's a real big problem within Savannah and County and Chatham, being able to get access to that point. If I got a stroller and I'm pushing a stroller, I got to push a stroller against uneven a path. And I just want to make sure that I brought that point up to echo what you said. And I'll further discuss it in our meeting next week. Thank you.
I wanted to say, because I'm allowed to talk as well, that when we are doing the 80-20, I'm agreeable to the 80-20, but for our seniors, we have stops that are near our seniors. I want us to have a plan, an education plan, where we explain to them what we're changing, how we're changing, so that we can accommodate them. I don't want to just tell them something. I want material that we can give to them explaining how we're going to change their system.
That all has to be part of it.
Yes, I will not agree to anything that upsets their apple cart.
Right. And remember, this resolution is just a resolution to give Grant the permission to start.
I understand.
He's going to have to come to us with a proposal, which we're going to have to vote on.
Right, but I think it's imperative to explain to him what our expectations are so that he doesn't have to go back and redo something.
Exactly, because that's going to be very time consuming.
And seniors are extremely important.
We agree.
Okay.
Some of us especially agree with that.
You're talking to the choir.
Thank you, Mr. French.
Okay, now can we have a motion to tables?
So far. I thought we already tabled.
No, we got tables.
We had to take that back.
I'm sorry.
Second. We do that.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, motion carries. Next subject, Curtis.
Can I ask a question real quick?
Yeah.
Ty, tell me if I can't ask this question, but because under this, we did have, are we bringing up the government reports, the lobbyist reports?
Yes, not in here.
We're going to.
It's not on the agenda, but
it's part of the executive part.
Okay.
Okay.
So we have to move on to the agenda. Which in the confusion I've lost. So the next thing is presentations. Do we have any presentations? In my mind, we table both 8 and 9.
Oh, yes.
They're related. So consultant services tables it.
Okay, just in case since Ty is nervous, we will need a motion to table the consultants.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Wait a minute.
Aye.
What?
I thought we paired eight.
I thought we did two.
Oh, you want to do them separate?
I want to do them separate.
That makes sense.
Oh, okay.
Because he's got them separate on the agenda.
I said that makes sense.
Yeah.
Yes.
All those in favor again, say aye.
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 Motion carries. Do we have any presentations, Dave Kurtz?
No, sir.
And executive report?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Your packets is the executive director's report. I would do want to highlight a couple of things. On the back, it references after ridership trends handout. And the chairman has asked me to include that in there. This was presented at the board members
conference in Chicago.
It's interesting. It goes through a variety of different, I wouldn't say reasons, but explanations of possibly why and where ridership has been moving. Is also the new approaches, as the chairman moved Sacramento, moving from a hub and spoke to a grid system, Columbus, Ohio, a higher frequency and high density corridors, Boston moving to TNC, which is like the Uber TNC contracts for demand response, Dallas and Phoenix integrated payment system, Los Angeles, a microtransit service. And the FTA itself put out a VOD sandbox grant last year, and they're looking to do so this year to basically come up with innovative ideas for alternative ways to provide transportation, which is what we've been discussing with our outlier areas under the coverage umbrella, alternative forms of transportation. But anyway, the board, just want to point that out to the board so they could take a look at that. I also want to point out we had a safety and loss control evaluation performed, and we see very favorable results. That's also behind the following page. If there is any questions on that, we can entertain that as well. And then also attached is the Factor Firm and the Squire Pen and Box legislative updates.
Now, this is our consulting firm.
Which one?
Becker.
Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Mike Becker's here. Yeah, Becker. You have a question.
He's hiding.
Okay.
Is there a state and local lobbyist? And then the Squire Pen and Box is the federal lobbyist?
I have a couple questions.
The federal. And how often did we hear from them? Federal.
They were actually here.
They presented back in June
presentation.
All right. So they we get a monthly report from them?
And they present once a year.
A couple of questions. One from Mike. The R or maybe Jurgen, whoever answers this, if there's even an answer, the RFP to conduct a broad study of transit in Georgia. Who is likely to be doing that, and is this going to be do you think this is going to actually be a good, valid study, or is this going to be reinforcing ideas that some legislators have?
From looking at the verbiage contained within the RFP, this is all inclusive. This is a soup to nuts project that will cover about an 18-month period. That will start looking at the state of the art, the state of the system, the state of transit within all different areas of the state. And basically, you've got Metro Atlanta, you've got rural, you've got the smaller urban systems and the large urban system here in Savannah. They will drill down and will be looking at service delivery options, what needs are being met, what needs are not being met, and then trying to devise a metric that will determine what needs to be provided both within individual regions, large regions and small regions, how you deliver that, and then how you actually fund that, and what role should the state have in providing that funding, and any role in governance as well that would be attached to that funding. There will be probably four or five different teams that will be assembled to work on this. I know that RS&H is one team That is actually being assembled with Jacobs, which is one of the national transportation entities. I would assume that we'll see names like Parsons Brinkerhoff and others as well that will come to the table. This is on a fast track. The decision or the RFPs are due week after next, with a decision being made by the September Transit Governance and Funding Committee. CERTA actually will be doing the evaluation of the RFPs to make a determination on which one that they will recommend, and then the decision on awarding that contract will be made by the Transit Funding and Governance Commission itself.
Would the report from whoever gets the RFP be available in time for action in next year's General Assembly session, or is it going to take longer than that?
It's going to take a while, but I think there will be certain things that will be available in an incremental basis. I do not view the existence of this report slowing down anything that's normally going to take place during the session. For instance, our continued pursuit of the TransPLOS legislation. I know that there may have to be some tweaks in the TSPLOS legislation as it relates to the ability for a single county to offer a TSPLOS, and how that relates to the ability of a region to reform and go forward with the TSPLOS. So there's some things that are going to have to be fine-tuned. I also view that what will happen is you will not be hit with a 700-page document at the end of 18 months. I see this, the way it appears to be organized is in silos, and it is very well reasoned and thought out on how they, what each one will build on the other one to come to the ultimate conclusions and recommendations. But I view that these will be released as they are finished to go to the commission, and then the commission will decide, yes, you are going down the right road, or no, that will not work in Georgia, and then they will back up and fine tune.
Will the Volkswagen settlement be, how that's going to be distributed, be part of any of this as well? Or?
It could be. We're still trying to get our hands around what is actually going to happen with the Volkswagen money and where that money is going to reside in state government. Right now, it's at the Office of Planning and Budget. That is the last that I have heard. I anticipate that sometime over the next 12 months, we will understand what is going to happen with that. But the disbursement of that 50-some million dollars also is a on a long-term basis. So Volkswagen is not going to be paying into the court-appointed registry a very large amount of money at one time. This, they actually will be paying this settlement over, I think, either a 5 or 10 year period. And then there is another component of that that is more on the promotional pilot project, et cetera, area that we have not seen untold yet. So we don't know exactly what that is going to look like. Also, each one of the states are going to have to file with the court and with the Board of Trustees what their plans are going to be as relates to implementation. It's still up in the air as to whether this is going to go through EPD or it is going to reside in the Department of Transportation. My guess would be it's going to reside in the Department of Transportation just because of the categories that they have identified that, yes, absolutely, the funding can be spent on. And generally, those are all forms of motorized vehicles that can be converted to electric, moving from motorcycles, bicycles, forklifts, trains, ocean-going vessels.
I have a second question, a little bit different topic, but this is federal, so I don't know if Mike can respond to it or not. But in the Squire Patton Boggs report, they indicated that the House said no to Tiger and the Senate said yes. Should we expect some kind of compromise that means there'll be some money, or is there any way to predict what's going to happen?
It is a moving target. You have a situation now that I think we've discussed before where the administration has laid out a transportation plan. The Congress has budgeted transportation money that is totally different from what the administration has done. And that goes for this year. The administration will lay out another transportation plan next year, and whatever Congress decides that they are going to do, and fund is what obviously the departments then are compelled to spend and implement. So right now, it's just a big question mark up there.
So yeah, the administration wants private money to pay for this stuff, public-private partnerships and all that. Congress still would like to see funding from the federal government, so maybe we'll see a hybrid of it at the end of the day.
A practical with private funding.
Maybe we have private partnerships. Public-private partnerships, yeah, that's where you get private money involved.
I know, but how practical is that?
How feasible?
Realistic is that?
It depends on what the project is and what private entities tend to gain from that project. So that's something that you'd have to look at. It's unique in any situation.
How feasible in this scenario?
You have to wait on
I think it's an education issue. I mean, it's private-public partnerships are successful with transportation in Europe. In the United States, we look at public transportation very unfavorably. I think it's just a process of re-educating people, explaining to businesses what their benefits are, how it's profitable to them to have people be able to get to them, their employees, you know. Everybody doesn't own a car. Everybody doesn't want to drive. Some people can't afford a car. So I think if we educate people better, we'll have more success.
Bill.
So it's one of those Tuesday half moon type. Hope it happened on Tuesday. Hope they got a half moon rather than a full moon.
Just one point. Beck, I see the submission for one of these is August 22nd. After this meeting, could you make sure that we get the transmission going down? Because I see both submission and contract award is after our meeting. So could you just make sure that we get that information?
Sure.
The transmission.
I doubt that I will be able to get access. Well, I probably will be able to get access after the 22nd call on what the firms were that have actually made submissions.
Okay.
Through service.
And I did see that with Square Patent and Vaults, you did secure letters from our leaders, I guess our leaders for our area. So that was actually really big on that piece. That's all I have.
Any other questions for Curtis? And I think we move on to unit updates.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The service delivery update is in your packet, and the staff will answer any questions you might have.
Are you going to report on it? You just need to.
I think we're good. If anybody has any questions,
I didn't have a question, but I made a comment about 4 or 5 months ago. This is before Mr. Brown was here. And that comment is in reference to projects. I'm a big project person. I like to see projects being implemented and completed or being passed on. And if we have sections on here which says, hey, we have projects going on. And I've given the buddy pass for the last couple of months because he wasn't here, he's brand new. But moving forward, if I can start seeing projects going on within the structure of CAT, within CAT, he'll help me understand that we're actually trying to implement and do things and being proactive as far as what we're doing.
KPI, paratransit, and that, you know, I hesitate to ask this because it makes me sound like a Grinch, and I don't mean to be that, not in this case, at least. But paratransit ridership, you know, we've had a 17% increase in clients since the same period last year. We've had a 105% increase in first care attendants and a 90% increase in companions. And I guess my question is, you know, we've got all these additional people traveling with the client. Is there a cost to us, and is that cost offset somehow? And I know this is a county cost, not the CATS, but all of that additional personal care, that seems like a huge increase in personal care attendance. With only a 70% increase in ridership to have a 105% increase in personal care attendance. I mean, are the people we're transporting now in worse shape than the people we have transferred before that need attendants and companions?
So obviously we can't control clients who need or want to bring a personal care attendant with them. What I do know is that over the last few months we've had some incidents with our clients where we're requiring personal care attendants. to be on board because of the situation and safety. So it just depends. I mean, we can't tell them they can't bring one.
Perhaps there's been some sort of a thing with their insurance. They've finally gotten a personal care person. Maybe they didn't have one before, or.
Or we've recommended that they need one if they're going to continue in our service.
Well, and I'm not suggesting we, you know, be Grinch-like about this, but by the same token, I just.
Well, the bus is still traveling to point A to point B, so if there's a companion on or not, it's still going to incur the cost of travel.
So there is no additional cost to us for the.
No. It would be different if there was only a couple seats on the vehicle, and then that would impair more clients to be on, but we don't have that issue, so it doesn't really do anything.
Driver mileage doesn't change.
And the cost incurred and the fee we receive is based on the service hour and not ridership.
Not ridership.
System development?
Thank you, Chairman. System development update is in your packet. If any board member has any questions, staff will answer those questions.
I had a question. Going back to the Airport Express, you said you promoted the new Airport Express route to select downtown hotels. So what's this? What's new with this?
Chairman, since July, we changed some of the routing for the Airport Express. So that's kind of what we did. We just went around to the downtown hotels. Now that we service downtown hotels as opposed to just going from the airport to the transit center.
So these are not new hotels. These are
right,
existing people.
Yes, sir.
All right. Next up is finance.
So I have to update in your packet. Terry, do you want to go over it or take questions?
Just two things. Good things. The final digest numbers were in, and the growth that we used to project our budget was 2%, and the digest growth was right at 4.1. So we've got a couple hundred thousand there. And also, the total hours on the city shuttle were finalized after the budget and ended up being a little bit more. So we've got a couple hundred in revenue there. We usually do a budget amendment in September or October after we've had 1 or 2 months worth of actual to know where we may need to adjust a revenue or a cost and reallocate some budget dollars. So with that amendment, we will incorporate the digest growth and also the additional revenue from total service hours on the city. And it will allow for us to pursue some of the projects and engagements we've been talked about over the last couple months. And I'll take any questions you have on the financial reporting package.
So these dollars that we found there are not being used, are we setting up a reserve?
We have a reserve built in our budget for the first time in recent history and maybe the first time ever. And you'll see that being accumulated at the bottom. That $830,000 is right at a 10 to 13 day reserve. So it's a very short time period reserve, but it is a start.
It is a start.
And with this additional revenue, we will look to the CEO and the board to decide if you want to increase that reserve or if you want to participate in the projects and the initiatives that we've been discussing after the budget was finalized.
So how much does the data dictate, or how much it suggests, I shouldn't say dictate, how much it suggests you should have in reserve? 10 days, 15 days, 20 days? 5 days,
it depends 40. On your tolerance for risk.
Right.
If you're on the conservative side in financial circles, a 60 to 90 day reserve is a preference. If you're more riskier, 30 days would make you comfortable. To put it in perspective, CAP has never had an operating cash reserve. And right. For the most part, we have operated with negative cash. So any reserve would really provide some stability that we need on an ongoing basis.
Okay. And what I'm thinking is, and my thought pattern is this. If we find that we budgeted X number of dollars, but we didn't use them all, if we move that into reserve, then we, rather than trying to just find, so, well, okay, we can do this or we can do that, which will spend that money, then we're also setting up for those things we can't predict, like hurricane comes again.
Exactly.
And we've got a transport post because FEMA say so, but we've got to fit the cost and wait 30 months before we get reimbursed. You see what I'm saying?
If we get
so
reimbursed.
We don't go negative in that particular instance.
But
because that's something
really,
we can't control, but we can prepare for.
You can't really massage money around like that, can you? I mean,
yes.
Isn't it earmarked for certain things?
No. What you're used to in full-blown government, where you have self-balancing and restricted funds,
yeah.
We are not set up that way. We are one single enterprise fund, and we are on the accrual basis, so there are no cash restrictions. If we did have a cash windfall, which I'm hoping for that day, we would record it just like we would any other revenue or cash balance, and we would look to Curtis and the board to direct whether or not we apply that to a special project or retain that in a contingency account. There are no self-balancing general fund, capital fund, debt fund, M&O fund. We're not set up that way. We are one enterprise fund.
Historically, you know, not having any kind of cash reserves, we've come really close a couple times. When the government has delayed funding, we've come really, really close to not being able to make payroll and buy fuel.
And that's
so
everything
it's really
occurs
critical.
With them.
It's critical that we
yeah.
get
yes,
some cash reserves
is.
To
it
get
is.
Us through it.
And that was where the millage increase and the service cut came into play. When the money comes from the increase in November and December, it will allow us to build even a small reserve, which will remove the possibility of risk in a payroll or having to delay vendor payments past our net 45-day terms.
Question. I see the fare box is included in the report. And I know this is a diverted question I should have asked earlier, but how are we doing as far as the fare box is concerned recovery? Are we doing a better job or?
It's about the same.
Okay.
What I'm seeing in the fare revenue is that we may have given a little bit more weight than we should have
uh-huh.
to one component of the reduction and not enough to the other.
Okay.
I'm hoping that we can do some analysis in July and August and maybe adjust that budget so that it's not showing negative all year long. With ridership down, of course, our fares are going to be down. And we did not anticipate that when we set our fare budget.
And I understand ridership being down is one thing, but I want to make sure we're capturing as much fare
as we can.
Fare box as we can, so we can move forward and say this is an actual problem elsewhere other than the fare box.
Exactly. And I haven't seen in any of the analysis that we've done that there's any concern outside of what we've already corrected, which was the trims and the motherboards and the
yeah.
fare boxes. And then again, ridership. So we've done a series of analysis, a series of reviews, and it's looking more like the only component that we haven't been able to correct is the ridership at this
okay.
point.
Thank you.
In talking about the contingency fund, it seems like that is such a critical need that just as a, at least a guideline, if not a policy, any windfall, no matter how large, some portion of that should be dedicated to going into the, I mean, whatever other special projects, whatever merit they might have, it just seems like we should be tilting most heavily toward trying to build that contingency, at least in the short term.
And it will position CAT financially to be a more preferred private-public partnership
yes.
participant. If you don't have the balance sheet and you don't have the cash, then you're not able to partner for these larger TOD park and ride projects or even a BRT project. You've got to have a balance sheet that will support the capital endeavor before a private partner would want to do business with you. And we have repositioned our financial revenues and expenditures so that by the end of the year,
we will see a huge leap in financial sustainability.
Right.
If we can just stick to the plan.
The contracts. I mean, the whole, it all adds up.
I tell you, the difference between now and when I came on board a year and a half ago is really marked.
Right. And put it in perspective, this $800,000 we're talking about is two payrolls. So if we had that in the bank, then the financial resources it takes to run the business day to day, month to month, those resources could be dedicated to financial planning, financial strategies, assistance with projects. So there's cost you don't see too. We've got folks on this every day. And the more cushion we have, then the less resources we devote to that, and we can start looking forward instead of having to manage on a day to day basis.
And one more question. With us going to a CAT advertising within our own bases,
mm-hmm.
how much revenue will we lose on the course of a year?
So the annual revenue was running between $100,000 and $130,000.
So we've got to replace that
right,
with something else.
But currently the contracts will not expire until February.
Okay.
So CAT's budgeted portion of the revenue should be covered with our share of the contracts that won't expire until the 10th month or 8th month of our fiscal year.
So when February comes, we have to replace that revenue with something, because that's revenue.
I think it'll be covered.
Okay.
And if it's not covered, we'll be 10 to 20,000.
I know it's
short.
Not much, but it's still
yes.
money, it's still revenue.
Yes, but we'll know by February, and then we will either adjust our expenditures to cover any shortfall or locate additional revenue sources. But I don't think we're going to be that upside down this year because the contracts continue through February.
Thank you.
So it's between now and then, you should get some indicators as to whether it's going up or down, right? Whether you need to make adjustments.
Well, with this particular program, we've terminated.
Right.
We have existing contracts that will provide revenue through next February, and then after that, there'll be no.
That's when we start.
But right. every month, we look at the revenues and the associated cost, and we adjust either within a department or within a program
yeah.
to make sure that at the bottom line, we're within budget. So if we're over in one area, we always look to contain cost in another so that we position ourselves to meet our annual budget targets. Yes, sir.
So we're paying for it.
Yes, we are.
Any other questions?
I'm good.
We're going to move on to new business. So Beverly, do you have something for us?
Sure.
New business. We have a new promotion we're going to start next board meeting. It's called Dump the Parking.
Oh, wow.
I'll be what?
Dump the Parking. So the challenge is going to be for us as board members and employees, since we're talking ridership, and we're talking our routes, and we're talking amenities, and we're talking our system, I'm going to challenge all of us next week to come by bus to the board meeting.
I ain't no problem with me. I'm good with that.
So we have for everybody passes, which are good for how long?
30 days.
So I would also ask all of us to, when we get a chance, ride the bus. Now, I did this last January, and I learned an awful lot. And if we're not regular bus riders, here's our chance to do something with it. So that includes, it's not fair for them because they're already here. So we'll have to take them down to your place so they can take the bus to get here.
All right.
This includes attorneys.
Okay. Thank you.
So that's our challenge. So next, let's all try to ride the bus and maybe we can
let me ask a question along those same lines. Since we've been talking about about making the county wide transit, maybe we ought to give some of those passes to some of the mayors and other county, the other municipality officials, asking them to do it. You know, because
don't turn it down for them. Let them turn it down.
Turn it down, right? And see, my reason for that is because folks who are making comments, and as I said it before, and I don't hide what I have to say, folks who are making comments about the transit service, there's a need that they don't see because they never rode the bus nowhere. And all their life, they always had, and it's like I told somebody last night that I was talking to, taking my own self, because when I talk about me, nobody can get mad but me. I've got exposure to 7 different cars no matter where I want to go. See, and I can always go to a car. I'm never without. But there are folks who live in Eastside Savannah who got a 20-year-old car. And if it break down, they got to get to work on the west side of town, in the far west side of town. So, you know, we sit here and make decisions because I've got access to 7 cars, but this person don't have access to but one, and that one's broke. So now he's needing the transit service to get him over there. See, and folks who are making decisions don't understand that because they don't have a need to ever ride the bus. See. And so if we can take those passes, just like you're saying, we come to board meeting next month on the bus, which is no problem for me because the number, the 29 will bring me right on in here. And I know that because I rode the bus, I ride the bus. But there are municipalities who decision makers who never get on the bus. Maybe we ought to just have some special event where we ask them to use the pass and get on the bus so they can know what it's feel like, so they can know that the people they're making decisions for know that they understand what their situation is.
I like it.
Yeah. I'm just asking if we expand.
I like the idea.
But if it costs too much, don't expand.
Can I get the app on my phone in time for next week?
Give an update.
It's the circuit. We said it's 30 to 60 days, so I don't know exactly when the timing's going to be on that.
So you want me to use the system, but
you can use the app. Well, most people use the system without the app, but you can use the app. I believe you can still go in there and use it.
Yes, you can.
I was told that until it's available at the app store, I can't use it on the iPhone.
No.
I can figure it out without the app. I just wanted to add that little pressure on the app.
All right, so let's move on. We have an executive session coming up. Actually, we have 2 sessions, and I think, Bill, on the first one, we have to ask you to go get some coffee.
The coffee's in here. I have to take it and leave. Okay, I guess we need to...
Motion to go into executive session for legal matters.
So moved.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Motion carries.
You got to stay in the
hood. You know, I thought about that.
I'll
call.
Hey, Mike.
Jay,
how you doing,
bro?
Always a pleasure. I appreciate it.